choice, James?
On Dust 2?
Yeah.
I think it just depends on your style, you know, team by team, basically. So I don't think there is a wrong decision here. People can generally consider it to be a slightly T-sided map, but I think either or works fine. So we're going to stick with these companies to with a slight money error, and then we'll be into the game. So in the meantime, we've got one of the Lunatic players are saying get ready to be rushed, so let's see if they if it's double jeopardy or if they are just going to go straight in to the B or A. So yeah, so Fuzzly apparently the man to watch on Lunatic, so we'll be watching him in earnest once they get to the buy round.
Yeah, definitely, yeah. we have a new mode on FACEIT here where we don't give money. You just play with the knives, and that's like for the whole 30 rounds. That's like what you do. Just kidding. There is an issue here for the money. They're gonna fix that.
Seems to be fixed. They've all got $800, so
there we go.
I think we're gonna be good to go. There is a pause, which has just been removed. So let's see if the B rush is real.
Then
bomb is kind of leaning towards the A bomb site on the terms of spawn. So it may go for a split here. We've got two guys with a good spawn for B on a C side. Nope, it's going to be A. So I think Nothing may have spotted one player there. Gotten a read, so Nothing's going to be heading towards the A bomb site on his own. And it is a...
So it looks like not live.
It's 1 hour for the first pistol round. So
oh, that's brilliant.
Yeah, little adjustments to do there. Config has been loaded.
Load that config. I'm so happy that knifing people doesn't incur costs of minus $9 billion anymore. And instead, it's like a more reasonable amount. That's like only $300. It's punishing enough at killing a teammate, let alone losing all your money. I mean, that's a bit hard, isn't it?
That was a long time coming.
Yeah, it really was.
Yeah, that was a very long time coming.
But jumping into this, actually, they are...
So it is a B-Rush off.
They're live now. We're seeing two men push from short. And actually, we're seeing a bit of an action here going in for a Lunatic. And Fugly's the last man standing. And to see what he's able to accomplish here by himself. He's going to just go down straight away. So pretty simple pickup of the pistol round there for Cloud9. It was a bit of a disjointed push. It felt like on B, they had two men towards mid who were very far behind the main push on B. And with Cloud9 being so aggressive on short, that was a recipe for disaster there. And then Lunatic were definitely unable to keep up there. It was a great reaction from Cloud9.
Once again, we've got the double scout eco, which for some reason we keep seeing more and more double scout on eco
rounds. I like it.
I don't like it. I've got to be honest.
I like it.
I think the failure rate of this tactic is far too great. And no bomb plants as well. It's
that mentality again that like they're gonna eco twice anyway, so they're just gonna go full buy. So why not on a map like this just get some scouts in the action instead of, you know, two extra P250s and armor. Get some scouts. Have some fun. Scouts are fun, James. You should try it sometime.
Maybe on deathmatch.
I mean, they move so fast, and Shazam, look, he is just hitting those heads, man. And look at this, turning the map right around on his head, taking over, long, getting those weapons, taking up the M4, and the bomb as well. And that should hopefully go down. Did they? What happened to the bomb? Did they? What is it? I think they're a little confused as to the position of the bomb there. They managed to finally get it. And meanwhile, Fogby's like, guys, the bomb.
They've taken so long to get the bomb that Shroud thinks that they're going to B, so he's rotated to the B bomb site. So that's worked out quite funny for them. He's like, oh, nope, back to the A bomb site.
That is brilliant. That is marvelous. But yeah, I mean, the scouts on this map, I mean, Mirage, you got a lot of cheeky angles for the jump shots. You can really abuse that. On this map, the jump shots aren't so prevalent, but the wide open spaces definitely make it pretty useful, I think, not just on finding picks, but rushes too. It can be a good support weapon on a rush. If you move so fast with it, that it's just, the scout is good. The scout is a good weapon now, and it's with the, since they lowered the cost for it, it definitely is, I think, worth it. And I like that teams are experimenting with it. I mean, unlike you, James, I'm liking the scouts.
Well, I mean, it was great individual play there from Shazam
to
open up that round of two headshots with the scout. But again, you know, overall, the it's reasonable in that situation because the rest of their team bought armor and pistols and etc. So they ended up with balanced money. But you know, you could buy a scout or you could buy an MP7 for the same price. I know, obviously it depends on the map, and the scout's probably more applicable on this. But just the double scout, I'm not too keen on
pistols, and it's you're forfeiting the armor. You're just saying I'm going to get a scout instead of having another PD50 armor. I don't know. It's a bit more utility in there. I'm not convincing you, am I, James? I'm not doing a good job, am I?
The numbers speak for themselves.
Either way, we're getting this push up along here, coming in from Lunatik as they make their way up over cross over there onto the A bomb site. It's a pretty easy affair to get this site under lock and key, and they gun down Cloud9 just with those pistols. Pretty, you know, full eco coming in from Cloud9 there. You know, no interest really to do anything other than just a full eco, get that economy going. And of course, you can see, you know, they're quite poorly for money still. So definitely can be quite a struggle. It always feels very uncomfortable, I feel, as a CT side, to be in a position where your money, your options very early on are very pressured with money, because your buys are pretty expensive. You kind of want two warps, like maybe even a scar. Like, some people will say, okay, I want a scar as my optimal setup. That's expensive. That's so expensive. And AK-47s, terrorists can just get away with 5 AK-47s just fine.
Off by Tempest there. Close range P250 to the face. Always good for a bit of damage. Let's see if they can pick up that weapon later on. He's going to head through the... No, he's just peeking through the doors now. He's probably going to pick up that weapon when he can. In the meantime, bomb's going towards the B bomb site now. They've been scared off from taking long.
Naf's able to find a pick. Great shot there from Naf. Tapping away Stroud's head. A big, big entry kill there, allowing his team to get into the bomb site. They might just be able to have the time to get the plant down as well. And a crazy angle there onto nothing. That's absolutely fantastic. Shazam onto Hiko. The onomatopoeia strong with this one. And we've got Sean Garris and Sempest making the move in, trying to synchronize their efforts in a 2-on-2 situation. Make that a 1-on-2 now. Sean Garris is left. Nothing but a prayer, an unanswered prayer at that, as he backs away, trying to save that weapon. Definitely, I mean, you got to hand it to Naf there, that long range pick, boom, straight in the bomb site, and that's what they needed. They needed that to be quick, clean, and fast.
Yeah, we should have won that. That was Lance's am. I mean,
what?
Terrorists win. So you can hear the Cloud9 team saying they should have won that round. But unfortunately they didn't, and it's 3-1 to Lunatik, and Lunatik with a fair amount of money already. We'll see if they choose to upgrade these FAMAS guns. We've got lots of AKs being bought, and an AWP gets thrown over to Shazam. He will peek middle double doors here. Justin get the first pick. Let's see if he gets one of the other guys. Oh, no wallbangs yet.
All right, so
Juvenile staying with the FAMAS.
Yes, I think we get to see what can be quite a standard round coming out from Lunatik here. They have the smoke down on mid, very standard. The play for short control, they've got dark control as well, is very standard. They're going to have the options readily available for B-split and also A-split. From the setup here for Cloud9, the B-split is not necessarily more favorable than the A-split at this point, because they're pretty well spread out. They don't have like a heavy bias towards long. They're not super far away. It's just Hiko on long. So right now, I feel like Lunatik really needs to get some more info here to really make a call on what's going to be the best move to go for. And we can see that they are kind of starting to converge towards the Xbox and next to the mid doors there as they look for more information. And it's like they might just see what they can get here with a quick peek up short, looking for that information. And maybe they can just hit the play on A. But they have Hiko actually. He's coming in from behind. He's pushed out the long doors. They're going to get taken out by Naf. Really nice now. Naf can go in through long. But actually, he gets cut down already. And Shazam on the back here. Shazam's in a really important position here with that AWP. He can deliver. Oh! Shazam gets one. Looking for the second. There it is, going to find that one as well. And brilliant stuff there in this round from Lunatik.
Sean Garrow's last man standing, 3v1. Looks like he's going to go for the save here. All the T's have expected and completely left the bomb site going off. Gets the first pick though. That gets taken out. Trade kill comes in from Juvenile. So that was, you can see the T's were really confident that of what was happening there. And they deserted the contact pretty damn sharpish once Sean Grouse was the last man standing for his team.
It was. I really liked just the slow style from Lunatik there. It was very methodical, and I feel like they're in a position where they're waiting constantly for information before making a move, trying to confirm what was the best move instead of just going, oh, I would have A split, or B split. Just instead of just going for it for no reason, they seem to be trying to find what the options are looking like and getting the information on positions. That's a damaging nade, my goodness. And before they hit the play, that setup there on Enable beat Cloud9 and they capitalized on it very well. And you see that boost coming up? That's kind of the counter of the smoke.
Oh, here's that plant finally.
Nice, the first time we get
plant
to see it.
Yeah, I mean, Nothing and Shroud both got tagged. At the beginning of this round, Lunatik had double AWP set up, and he managed to get two tags on Nothing and Shroud. But now it's Cloud9 who have double AWPs, and they're dotted all around the map at the moment. So I don't know if they're going for exit frags here. We've got Shroud in the pit with a P250. And the other guys looking to save their AWPs and leave the Pistolers here to try and get some exit frags here. So Hiko, see if you can get anyone from short, but it doesn't look like we will as they head towards long.
Oh, did they? Oh no, okay, they didn't.
They got Shroud, just a P250, yeah. Right. So still double AWP for Cloud9. We'll see who the second AWP goes with. Currently on Nothing, but we'll see if he keeps it.
Are they doing this for spawns? I think they might be doing this for spawns. And let's have a look and see how this round goes for Cloud9. You know, ooh, quick B play coming in. Oh, the smoke's there. Nope! Nope! Not gonna go through that smoke.
Whoa, slow down.
And that's gonna slow them down indeed. So these AWPs are really, really key here for Cloud9. And if Lunatik are able to effectively circumvent the AWP play, then Cloud9 are going to be in such a horrendous position.
They're nowhere near either AWP at the moment, but they'll probably end up facing the one on short at least.
It's like grenade coming out to Hiko. Hiko tasked with a one-man job. And Cloud9, if they have one-man jobs, often you see it will almost always go to Hiko. Because I guess they just feel so confident in his ability by himself. And honestly, he delivers. And we see Shazam managing to get a pick on DeSantis there. And that's going to allow them to slowly get more and more ground here. You know, opening up middle. Now Cloud9, three guys left. They got to worry about middle. They got to worry about A and B at the same time. He has a lot of options to Lunatik to just converge on one location together. Looks like they're going to go to a B split here, majority through dark. This is going to be dangerous.
Timing. Nothing's left the bomb site at a completely wrong time. And now we've got three people in the bomb site, including the bomb. And they go for the retake, and Sam's going to miss his shot. Should have got that one, really.
Ticking away there, Cloud9. Trying to work for this retake. 3 versus 4. Gathering
up
here.
One of them's in T-spawn, though. This is going to be difficult. I mean, by the time he gets there, they're not really going to have time to push, which is why they're all retreating now, opting to save their weapons instead. It's going to be 6-1 to Lunatik here. Are they going to smash Cloud9 again?
You can see how protective they are of these weapons. They know that like once they lose these AWPs, they really lose chance to gain momentum. Because even if they win a round, Lunatik are going to have so much money that they're going to have even the big advantages on the ranges still. So if Cloud9 Deeps try to hold on to these advantages and turn it into like momentum in the game, and they're going to lose an AWP there, that is a big, big loss. They still have, you know, decent stocks here for the money. It's looking okay there, bank generally speaking, but
If they saved that, they could have done a full buy with nades for all the players. Instead, they're going to be mostly there, but Shroud only with a smoke and a flash. Tempest with no nades at all, so that was a possible loss for the team. They have a few people bomb rushing along here for the terrorists. They'll probably put some back and try and take the team at the same time, but they can clear that long. And still one in T spawn here. Shazam with the AWP looking down mid to CT spawn.
Get himself closer there for an angle on short. And once again, we can see they got a player in long. He doesn't have to do anything but just present a threat. And they're actually going to go for the take on long here. Hiko, first man. They try to go for it. Gaps does take Hiko down. The trade's coming in. And it is two men lost for Cloud9. Almost spotted indeed. And they're very aware that long is lost here. And it's like they're going to go for the rush onto this A bomb site there. will be making his way in. Tap, tap onto Sean Gares to take him down on that bomb site itself. And it is a plant for long here. And you can see they do have a member in the pit. So this should be really hot stuff here for Lunatik in this post-plant setup. Nothing, and Shroud have a lot of work to do. And there you go, though. Shroud trying to make his way through the smoke. Going to pick off one kill. Looking for the headshot on the second player remaining on the bomb site. Juvenile. Juvenile playing it very easy there, and he's going to find the kill onto Shroud. Amazingly played by Lunatik, so wonderfully done. Taking that long control first of all, and just slowly building on it. Cloud9 wanted a quick retake, and it didn't go their way. It's a risk, and I think that that's a decent risk to go for. It's unexpected as well, but ultimately it put them in an even worse position.
It's 7-1 Lunatik right now.
Do you just want to let that sink in a little bit?
Yeah, it's interesting, but oh, I was going to say, I mean, we did have the veto system here, but I guess Cloud9 are confident that they could take that's 2 seconds time around, as they didn't seem to remove it from the veto system here. Okay.
Someone needs to spot there.
No, this is my fault. I took a long
7-2, unless we see some more fast picks here come from
not
the
even. This was an AK, so he's
probably. Tempest sees the shadow and gets the kill. And this should be 7-2 to Cloud9, and maybe an additional AWP.
He's under a lot of pressure, trying to solve an escape, but he's going to get taken out. 7-2 the score as the Cloud9 pick up around finally for them. This is definitely looking a bit scary for the Cloud9 lineup. You can see Shazam rocking the AWP once again, and it can be interesting to see if we're not going to actually see an AWP. Oh no, we've got an AWP on Sean Gares. Where is he taking this AWP exactly? Is he going from mid here? He's going to go for the B play. And we actually have three men on B, so I think I'm actually pushed Dark here. Dark takes are really, really powerful, not only on surprise, you know, frag hunting, but just getting the info. And look at that, nothing going to take down Nath early into the round. And they have to be scared to move into Dark now. They can't know whether or not Cloud9 are moving through to lower Dark, so they're going to just rush through short. They feel the pressure coming in from behind.
They've got to push the side before the CTs rotate as they saw the, you know, these things completely closed off for them. So it's going to be a war of attrition here as they push the site.
And it looks like we're going to see a short plant, I think. Yeah, it's a short plant again.
Oh!
Oh, the double from the spray down. Nothing coming out huge there. And it's players left now. But it is a short plant. Another one going down. The defuse going down as well. And Shroud going to be covering. Too easy. And another round for Cloud9, very easy cleanup. I think, you know, I think that the pressure of that Dark take really, you know, kind of lit a fire under the ass of Lunatik there. They were like, God, we just have to go for it. We can't fall back onto Dark. We just have to go for this short play.
Yeah, they needed to take the site before the additional CTs could get into position. So they felt like pressure was on there. All, you know, so they did manage to get the bomb down, but. Unfortunately, Cloud9 proved too strong with that great tactic at early stage. I do wonder if they watched the game where I think the MBK's team who pushed B tunnels earlier.
They're just running and just calm down, dude.
Oh, got some infighting there on the Lunatik side. So again, they are 7-3 up. So 7-4 now. Let's have a look at their money actually on the Lunatik side. Looks like they're going to be forced into an eco. So Cloud9 should be looking good for 5-7 here, and the late comeback into this match.
Yeah, Lunatik would definitely be served well by getting as many rounds as possible and closing this out as quickly as possible. Cloud9 are quite deadly when you give them anything at all. We've seen that in the past. And in they go now. We've seen the lower Dark take coming in from Cloud9. Can they hold on though? Not quite. Only actually getting one kill for the price of nothing's life there. And they're going to be able to fall back onto Stemphasis, warping over on the mid there, but he needs some help. He's going to get it in the shape of his grenade, and there goes the four-man. Stemphasis going to be holding on strong there at mid, which is really, really nicely done. That's going to bring them to 7-5 now, and Lunatik definitely not looking quite as good as they were earlier on, but Cloud9 look more like Cloud9 as well.
Cloud9 have strung a number of rounds together, gone for a double AWP set up this round. We've got Stemphasis and Shaw and Gares with two AWPs, and I mean, they've won like three rounds in a row now, and they've built a fair amount of bank, so they're going to be good. We've got Stemphasis with $13,000, $14,000. So I don't think we're going to see any more ECOs for them on this first half. See, it's a bit of a more passive round here from both sides, although we do have someone peeking into B now, but he is going to be walking into a crossfire setup, so there we go.
Splat.
Gets picks in from the wrong direction. That's going to leave the CTs of one person on B. And that's Sean Garris with the AWP, so not the worst scenario in the world. However, we've got nobody mid right now for the CT side, although the T side will probably be a bit wary of peeking because that's unbeknownst to them and they could get orbs as far as they're concerned.
But they still have three smokes left, so okay, there we go, the smoke for CT spawn. We're going to see that that's like push coming from Daps just to create confusion here. Oh, Shroud, aggressive play. He's going to find out everything he needs to know. Takes down two players there by Long. And Cloud9 have to know what's happening. Their Zach gets taken down over by Xbox. And they can hear it. They know what's happening. The last two players over at Long. Smoke's going down on crossover to force those close range engagement. Boom! Sean Gares long distance onto Shazam with that AWP. And now, you know, Naf is left with a lot of work to do.
8 seconds.
No time to do it.
You heard Semper say good job to Shroud, because not only did he get two picks, but he also exposed the location of the bomb, so they knew that they didn't have to defend B or send extra plays over there, so that was great play by him. Not only for the frags, but also for the information, which definitely helped Cloud9 win the round with superior positioning to their team, and nothing saying hello, something or other, but I think I was talking over him, unfortunately, so left to repeat that.
Alright, in the B they go. Cloud9 mounting their defense. So far, they're going to pick up one kill. They're getting closer and closer to these terrorists. Pressure's on now. Cloud9 going to pick up two kills there. Well, three in total. But the bomb is going to go down. 2-on-3. This is not the worst situation ever, but look at this. Cloud9 already on top of Lunatik. See Shazam going down. Daps, left hand of three, going to go down as well. Has to look at too many angles at once. We're going to see a defuse coming in for the 7-7 scoreline. Cloud9 with a big series of rounds back-to-back.
You can see the baiting by the window there from the CT who was up top. He was kind of jumping to tease a push to try and bait the remaining terrorists and to try and shoot him so his teammate could get an easier kill, a free kill, if you will. And he didn't go for the bait, but they got the kill anyway, so worked out in their favour. 10-5 with an aggressive position. Is he going to peek lower? Doesn't seem so on this occasion. And they're two fast picks on the A long here, and they're going to push straight to the site. But
I wasn't expecting that, holy fuck.
This will slow them down somewhat.
That is my fault. Oh, well.
Poison will be huge right now.
No!
Oh, and they're getting flanked now, and it's all falling apart here for Lunatik, and it's going to be 8-7 Cloud9. What has happened? They had such a good opening to this round, and the pick from the CTs just slowed them down, and I don't know where that flank came from, but it came fast, it came hard.
I probably look retarded with my nade out peeking mine.
Has it all to do now, but it's looking unlikely, to say the least.
It's just funny listening to their reactions to that huge flank play on the comms. We see Naf though, he's not amused. Gonna pick off Sean Gares there, trying to get the frags in. There it is, 1-on-1 now. 4 points of health, doesn't get it. It's gonna be Cloud9 winning the first half, 8-7. Big spree of rounds. And I don't know, what do you think that Cloud9 is gonna be stronger on the T side?
It was looking pretty bad there for Cloud9.
Yeah.
But all of a sudden it's 8-7. So who knows? I'm enjoying Lunatic's play, to be honest. I mean, it's like it's a learning experience in terms of us familiarizing ourselves with their players and their play. And again, after two really fast picks on A long there, it's a real shame that they didn't manage to convert that round. But you have to hand it to Cloud9 for a massive flank there to bring the round back into their favor.
Yeah, certainly as we wait for the next map, or rather, sorry, the next half even to start, I have to say that it's just so awesome to see Cloud9, because I became a fan after ESL 1, and the performances that we saw there, they just have so much character to the team. It's great to watch them play. And it's also great to see, as you said, you know, a team like Lunatik come into the fray here and also not just give them good games, but also show that they have also their own character and style coming into it. Perhaps not as well known, but something that's going to be developing over time. And we, as we move into this pistol round, we are seeing...
We've still got two guys in T-spawn here for Cloud9. We had three guys firing down mid-double doors.
And that is why it seems that's unbelievable at that range. Pretty big pickoff there. And actually, that was a PT-50, so you know you can see that it's going to be a little bit more accurate than the Glock at that range.
Semphis all the way from T-spawn gets the first pick of the round. Yeah. 1 minute remains here. Cloud9 still need to breach a bomb site here. We've got two CTs in either bomb site. And probably see what looks like a four-man push here on A long. So, but again, time is running out here. 45 seconds remaining. So we've got the CT stretched out there. We've got Shazam now in CT spawn and only one person on the A bomb site. So this is going to be bad here for Lunatic. And this like a pop his head. Does get one, but the bomb is going to make it to the site now. And Kiko's going to look for the flank here, but he's looking the wrong way. Managed to get the kill, but Daps gets a trade kill. But it is a 3v1 here, and he's going to go. He's not going to get very far out of CT spawn.
Yeah, I mean, Cloud9 were just perfectly set up to just absolutely crush that round, not only just getting the pick early on, but interestingly, it's kind of funny because it's almost like it's pistol chicken. Because with the pistols, it's at those ranges on Dust 2, those really long ranges, it's kind of random. It's a little bit random. Like, it's not something you can rely on. I mean, you can both be aiming dead on the other guy's head, and it's going to feel a little bit random still. So, it's who was brave enough to actually stay in there, and they got rewarded. Cloud9 got rewarded that first pick, and in they go for the push onto long. And so far, it's a lot of damage being dealt to them as Lunatic are actually holding on pretty well. This scout and pistol buy here. Scout's a good change. I'm not going to let it go. I'm going to convert you, I swear. I like how you have absolutely no comment there whatsoever. It's brilliant. Look at this. Daps coming from behind there. Beautiful stuff. Getting a good solid tag. Going to go for the finish with the pistol. That is going to find it. And back out with the scout for the jump shot over the Xbox. Not going to quite find that shot just yet. But his team is at a player advantage. Lunatic have gone one man up now with just nothing in Semphis left alone for Cloud9. They've got the bomb. But only 40 seconds to create a play around it. It looks like their choice is long.
How the fuck do we lose this round?
It looks like Sean Garris is
well, I guess we didn't lose, but how are we in this situation?
Oh, I'll let him do the talking for now.
Oh my god, that's brilliant. That's so hot. That's so funny. Boom, Shazam with the scout coming in. The nice little frag. That's the tap action of the Galil. And yeah, I mean, how do they lose this round?
Well, it's important. It's important to note that they are asking the right questions. Like they want to know, they want to understand why they lost that round and why they ended up in that situation with only two of them left versus the anti-eco. So that's something important. You know, you need to look at the rounds you lose and figure out why. But also the rounds you win as well. You know, if something didn't go as well as it could have, etc. It's always something to learn from every round.
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty smart as well. I feel like, you know, that play for long was almost a little bit predictable because long is really, it tends to be a bit more safe than other options against an eco because you can stick all together, long ranges generally. There's not a huge amount of places for them to hide as there are on the other sites. So it's less friendly to the pistols, but we saw the scouts and pistols coming in there. So it's a good defense, good little bit, you know, little stacking action there from Lunatic to really yield a good result. And we're seeing them push on mid here now, coming in on the next round for Cloud9 as they drop it on court as well. Very, very creative stuff there. Just Geronimo as they are able to pick up some weapons here. Shroud with that M4. Holding on pretty well though. They've only lost one player so far. The couple still very low. And the control of the situation, they've boxed them in there over on CT spawn. They know that Shroud is there with that M4. They know he's low, and there it is. They'll make the kill. 9-9. And Lunatic tied the game up.
Minimal damage there, only losing one player as well, which is really important for them. So they're all about 4,000, apart from Nephilim, who has to drop a gun. So, yeah, they seem in good stead now with the Cloud9 team on an eco, but they have to make sure they don't get ecoed in this round, otherwise they're not going to be in the best of financial situations here. So we've got one, they're keeping long ranges as you can see here. Juvenile's having a look at long, where we're going to see a full commit push from Cloud9 here. So he's retreated back to the bomb site, keeping his long ranges again, which is really sick. Good decision making here. We've got team flashes coming in, allowing him to peek, get some tags in HP remaining. Can he get out of sight, out of mind? Shazam covering the angle with the AWP. Great question. Shazam gets second one. Bomb is going to make it onto the bomb site, which is going to give the T's the money to full buy in the following round.
I pre-sunk mid, which is why that guy is dedicated over there.
Anyway, on edge.
That's fine, but yeah, we should have just started
to get this approach actually yield a result, but they're finally just clearing them up here. I'm going to go for the defuse, but you know, that bomb to get planted, going to get paid that the mad dollar for that plant, if not to win the actual round. But that's fair enough. And they did actually manage to take down two players as well. So you can see that, you know, although the economic situation isn't horrendous by any stretch of the imagination for Lunatik, it's pretty decent still. They are close to forcing that eco, as we can see now. If actually this round is won, I think they can still buy, but it's going to be, they're going to have absolutely nothing on the next round. So
whoa, nothing has accidentally bought an M249.
You don't accidentally buy a Negev. You just, that doesn't happen, James.
That's an M249, isn't it? Or is it Negev? Oh, he's gone full Negev.
Full Negev in the house.
Shout out to Gone Wild Negev on Reddit.
Gone Wild Negev is the best. All right, so.
Oh dear, I can't wait to hear the reaction of this.
Suppressing fire.
This is what I call brute force.
Alright, I'm
disappointed there's no Negev skin though.
Yeah.
I mean, this guy needs to get trading on CSGO launch.
And not hard to find. So I'm gonna see some smoke.
I have a Negev skin, which is worth like £12.
Alright.
Anodized navy.
Maybe you should give it to nothing.
Alright.
Alright, well either way, we're going to see something chucking over those nades. That play
he's playing support Negev right now.
Support Negev. Alright, nothing's first man here. Straight from the smoke. Going to be trying to clear out long. It's going quite well for them so far. And Lunatik, they don't even see the Negev yet. They haven't even felt the power of the Negev just yet. It's not even coming into play. He's supporting Negev, man. He's
minding his own business.
Yeah.
Negev.
Oh no! Not even a single bullet fired. Someone pick up the Negev quick.
What's so fucking wrong when I died, man?
Oh my god, there's some anger. There is some anger. So, there's no time left. I guess they had the plant in the works, but someone please pick up the Negev. Please. What? James, explain the events that just took place.
He didn't even fire a bullet.
He didn't fire a bullet and they didn't pick it up. It's a crime, James. That is a crime.
Oh, think of the children, guys. Come on.
The poor children. Either way, I guess it was an accident, but that's just really weird.
Well, yeah, it was an accident.
Alright. Now, this is
so it's interesting. Fugly's got $38.50 left, but he hasn't bought a rifle. So they have he has a P250 but no rifle.
Picked up an
AWP here, presumably from long where they got that first pick. And their only juvenile left 20 pistol has grabbed an AK. So Cloud9 in
these
trouble now.
Spectators.
Anyway, we have a 3-on-5 situation going on here. We got Cloud9 making their way towards the bomb site. Daps in the takedown, Trinkers. They can't even get out of the tunnels before they all get gunned down by Lunatik. Lunatik are really pulling things together. It really feels like on both teams, tensions are quite high from what we can hear from the comms.
Yeah, I can hear some frustration here. But I mean, there are $50,000 on the line here. You know, there are six teams in this from the US, and two of them will go to the LAN finals. So there's a lot to play for. This is an important time for them.
That Negev, I'm still curious what that was all about. Because look at the money. That the Negev is so expensive. It's like 3M4s almost.
Yeah, like, yeah, that is
but 2M4s. Either way, we got Cloud9 taking over long there. You know, forcing the team back out of that position. They still have a lot of options here for taking short as well. Great little pickup there from Sean Gares. Oh, Sempfis going to find himself a frag on the Juvenile with that P250. Fugly over by CT Spawn. They're trying to see what he can do. Not the best position in the world, but the bomb should go down without any further issue on that A bomb side.
Quite
just holding position there, waiting for his teammates to come around short so they can get some coordination going here, some synchronization in this push, as Hiko just crawls, creeps, sneaks his way up short to try to go for the backstabbing maneuver. Great tap action there from James. Michael Flatley would be proud. Left here against Hiko in center. He's going to go down with ease. And Cloud9 take the round back. It's a very back and forth issue here, James, between these two teams.
Yeah, Lunatic will be able to buy, though. Still got an AWP as well. So 11-11, this could go down to the wire. Both teams are pretty damn poor at the moment. So this is going to be a very important round. We may see an eco here. If the T's can't get a bomb down and lose the round, they're going to be on eco. If the CTs lose the round, they're going to be on eco as well. So, you know, I think this is a critical round, basically. And we may see a two-round lead from the people who win this particular round.
Yeah, absolutely. So, again, we're going to see that standard play around here, taking control of mid, taking control of short, dark. They have everything. In fact, they're actually going to forfeit any kind of a play on short at all, which actually kind of works out here because the B split is going to be good when we see Shazam and also Hiko very far away. They're going to be fast here into B. They're going to make their way through here. Hiko, rather, Juvenile is very fast on the push from long. And they still have to deal with Naf, who's sitting in that B bomb site. He's going to get two before he goes down. And it's looking good here for this bomb plant. But the CTs are definitely hot on their heels.
That's so confusing.
Guns down,
like, whipped back, and
with Shazam left, but AWP, okay, there's surely not a lot of hope left for him to pull this one off. He's going to get taken out. Cloud9 to pick up the 12th round to the 11 of Lunatik.
Yeah, now you see the CTs are forced to eco here, which will give Cloud9 a 13-11 lead. I don't even think. Let's see if they go for pistols here. We've got Fugly going for a P250, and we're going to see three P250s from the CTs, but they don't even have enough money to really all go for even pistol purchases here. So this should be 13-11 to Cloud9. Then Lunatik are really going to have to raise their game to come out of this alive. Get the eco frags here from Stroud on long. It's going to get a fourth one.
It's just like playing deathmatch, grinding them down. And, just one by one, they're trying to get a kill in the Cloud9. They are going to be taking it, of course. And let's get down as well. There it is. Stroud taking his kills. But 13-11 the score as Cloud9. They earn that eco, and then they collect, James. They collect that money, and they collect that round.
Lunatik on the ropes here. They can buy rifles here. They pretty much have to, but they're going to be low on the grenades, which means, obviously, they can only hold off parts of the map for so long. They have two smoke grenades and three people with helmets at the moment. But the helmets don't really matter at this point, you know, versus all AKs and AWP. Probably better spent on an additional grenade, maybe a smoke grenade or something.
So here we go, we've got that that short presence coming in from Cloud9. Obviously we can see three of them congregating around the upper B dark area, as it is very likely that they're going to go for this B split here whilst kind of making the presence known on short, putting the fear of the A split in them, or in fact trying to sell a fake here. And right now Lunatik have heard nothing on A long, so it might be hard for them to actually go for this fake, but let's see if it actually works out. In fact, they do get the pick onto the back of the site on B. So that site, regardless of whether the fake was sold or not, is actually going to go their way. They're going to get that bomb down. And it's, I mean, you can't just walk in alone. We see, you know, one of the players of Lunatik is the B tunnels. He's ready to attack, but he needs his teammates to come in with him. He can't go alone. Daps is just waiting there. He's waiting. Shazam needs to hurry himself up right there to allow Daps to push in and synchronize with him. But in fact, they realize that it's a lost cause. They're going to back away, save those weapons, and try to play a better round next round. But Cloud9 are creeping ever closer to that 16-round scoreline.
You can see the professional players always pick up the AK and drop the M4 when they come across one, because one shot to the head, you're dead. It's very important to have the advantage as well, especially when your economy isn't the best. You know, it can really flip around for you. So,
I thought it was just for the skins.
I play with some people who will drop an AK to pick up an M4, which makes zero sense to me. You know,
It's the AK is a better weapon.
Yeah, it's a complete no-brainer.
It is a better weapon.
Something worth pointing out sometimes.
And alright, we can see now Cloud9.
Again, they've gone for the three-man push down long, and one of them's being picked off by Senfis, and nobody's on the A-bomb site again.
You gotta be careful of that. If you get the good timing, the terrace is too easy. And Hiko got his good timing too there, and we can see that like Daps had to jump out of that position, that little aggressive play to them close to that corridor. It didn't work out.
Are they being overly aggressive? Because they're peeking and they're just getting picked by the
That's unbelievable.
Superior
man, I started flashing it and you pick long.
You can hear the frustration from the team now. And
hey,
he's fighting,
what
but
the
I
fuck?
Mean...
That's the whole point of the flash.
They all face... They all face reasonably early and then, you know... They all face and all got picked, basically. I mean, what more can you say about that?
Yeah. Definitely. So match point now for Cloud9, as from the sounds of it, the tension's still running very high for Lunatik. And at the moment, we do have the buy coming in. We got scouts, we got mags, we got FAMAS for Lunatik, which does definitely, you know, give us a hint as to, you know, the issue for them right now. Shazam, the last guy left with that scout.
Hey, it's your scout left.
Yeah, whatever, James.
Let's see what he can do with it. Oh, he's okay. He's still top.
Man, you hate the scout. I can't believe it. So there you go, guys. It's 16-11 final score. We do have Cloud9, who actually are able to surpass Lunatik there. But it was a good performance from Lunatik.